Worship Center. We meet here Sunday at 2:00 in Kingston, Tennessee, and thank you for joining us. So, all week long, you know, I've been thinking, you know, this year we've covered a lot of things. We've covered healing, and then Pastor Sam has preached, and I knew that it was, you know, time for me to come back, and I'm like, you know, Lord, what is it you want to begin to deal with us about? And you know, God has never done dealing with us. I don't know if we've all figured that out. Just if you haven't, newsflash. We're never going to be perfected on this side, so he's always going to have something he'd like to tweak in you if you'll let him. So, you know, I said, where are we, you know, as a group? And what is it that as this group that you would like to work on with us? And so I was thinking, and there was actually two different areas that he was kind of speaking to me about. And so for today, you know, sometimes we struggle with our perception of ourselves. We have no problem seeing other people and seeing how wonderful other people are and thinking, oh, they're just so great and they're so cool and I just see the great things, you know, God is doing with them. And we just have this, yeah, what about me? And we don't see anything, you know, in ourselves. And we just have this hard time in seeing what it is God could see in us that would make us useful to the kingdom. And so, I began, God, from Bible study, you know, our Bible studies, we would just love to have everybody get involved in that. And I think you'd be surprised. It's not a boring Bible study, is it? No, it's a good Bible study. So we're always end up thinking and seeing things. And I started thinking about that. Why does it seem like God chooses certain people and we find them recorded in the Bible as standout people? When there's this whole crowd of people, what makes them seem to be special? What draws God's attention to them? And so, I want us to talk about one of those people, one of those persons in the Bible. We all go into Genesis. Oh yes, we're going old, isn't it? Genesis. And go to Genesis 29. And you know, the Old Testament and the old patriarchs are recorded, it says, for our benefit, that we might learn. And I want to read for you Genesis 29:31. Genesis 29:31 says, when the Lord saw that Leah was unloved, he opened her womb, and Rachel was barren. Do you realize God sees our condition? He sees our situation. He sees what's going on with us and our situations and relationships with other people. And he cares. He cares about it. Now, we've been in our Bible study and we've been talking about it. You know, a lot of times we have to think about, you know, a lot of the Bible is from a Hebrew or Hebraic perspective, and we're Gentiles. So we have to learn how to look at it and educate ourselves on that perspective. So even in the New Testament, we're actually studying Matthew. We just started Matthew. And I started questioning God because we're studying Jesus and his natural flesh and his lineage. And it keeps coming back to, you know, we know this title of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. And as, even as Gentiles, that's common to us. Lion of the Tribe of Judah. And so most of us know, okay, that there was 12 tribes, you know, that there were 12 sons. And I started thinking, but Father, why? And if I was going to title this message, this would be what I would title it. Why Judah? Why Judah? And don't we think when God says, oh, hey, I've got this ministry I want you to do, don't we think, why me? Why me? Somebody else is probably better, might be more talented, might have more experience, they're a better speaker or whatever. So why Judah? Why you? Why me? Why her? Why does God pick certain people out of a crowd of people? So I want us to look at why people stand out and what makes some people get selected by God. Don't you think that would be something good to know?
Absolutely.
That's a really good thing to know. What makes God select certain people? Okay, why Judah? Let me tell you a little bit about Judah. And about Judah's story. Now, Judah is one of 12 brothers. Well, that's not a good start to stand out, is it? He's one of 12 brothers. And unfortunately, his mother is the unloved mother. She's not even the favorite wife. That's probably not in his favor either, is it? Okay, well, maybe he can overcome that. Well, Judah has an oldest brother. I'm sorry. Yeah, Judah has an oldest brother, Reuben. And then he has Simeon. And then he has Levi. Judah is the fourth kid. That's probably not real helpful to make you get noticed much either, is it? To be the fourth son of the unloved wife. Not much in his favor going on here, right? So, let me tell you what happens to Judah. So Judah and these 12 boys, you all know, they decide that they're really super jealous of their half-brother, Joseph. And they all decide, they conspire to kill him. They're going to kill him because they're just tired of him needing favor. Now, the oldest brother just says, oh, let's not kill him, let's not kill him. Let's just sell him. We'll just sell him into slavery. Like that's, I mean, it is better, I guess. Okay, so does this sound like a real loving group of brothers? No. So this is not a good family situation, right? So he's got some pretty jealous brothers, a pretty unloving family situation, right? And he's the fourth kid. So you know dad's not giving him much attention, right? So, okay, he's involved in this conspiracy. So now he has to start lying to his father. Lying about what really happened to the brother. And this has got to go on for years and years. Now, that's a pretty bad family, right? Oh, that's not it. That's not as bad as I get. So then, his sister gets kidnapped and molested, and when they find out who it is, then those people come and say, hey, you know, our son, he's a prince, he really loves her, we want her to get married, and we're all gonna, our city is gonna be okay with your tribe, rather say, well, you know what, then you know you got to circumcise and we'll all be cool. And so his two older brothers that are just, you know, like a year or two older than him, they conspire another deal that if this whole city does this deal, we're going to murder them. And what makes it worse is Simeon and Levi go through with it. They set him up. A whole city of people. And so they murder all of the males after they set him up and make him so weak they can't fight him. Now, keep in mind, this is Judas, like 1 and 2 year old older than him brothers. So not only do they sell their own brother into slavery, but now they're murdering whole cities, a whole city of people. And as if that's not bad enough, then they take this whole city's children and women as slaves. Do you think they sound like they're very merciful brothers? Do they have very much compassion? Their own father, okay, Judah's own father is afraid of his two sons. Is this a good family? Judah doesn't have a good family, does he? This is not a good family setting he's growing up with. Do you think he has much trust with his brothers? Do you think he believes his father has any control over his brothers? Do you think he feels real safe in his own family? No. Okay. So, after this happens, Judah decides to leave. Do you know? Now keep in mind, we're thinking, why Judah? Why does God pick Judah out of the 12 boys? After this all happens, Judah leaves. He's the only one of the boys that just leaves this craziness. Judah leaves. He takes off. And he goes and he marries a Canaanite woman. He has three sons with a Canaanite woman. And she remains his wife until her death. They stay together. And the first son, God kills because he's so evil. The second son has to marry the wife, the widow. And God kills him too for being evil. So he has one son left. Do you think he's having a hard time? Do you think Judah's having a hard time? Do you think Judah's thinking I'm hiding favor to God?
No,
he's not probably feeling really good about his life at all. So two of his sons God has killed because they're so evil. He's got a third little son, and because of tradition, he's got to keep this boy back and let this boy, when he grows up, marry this widow that's already got been widowed by his first two little sons. Do you think he's feeling real loved? Real favored by God. Great things is going to happen for me. No, he's thinking, I've got one boy left. And once he marries her, I'm probably going to lose him too. So, he tells her, you go on back, you live with your father, and when my youngest boy gets old enough, I'll give him to you, and you'll have a husband. In the meantime, his wife dies. And time goes by. He leaves where he normally lives, and he goes up to, you know, they're going to shear the sheep. Well, do you know sometimes when we get out of town and we go on vacation and we get away from familiar things, we can do crazy things and make bad decisions? Because we think nobody's gonna know. Nobody's gonna know what I did in Sin City. Well, Judah does that. Judah, he sees a harlot on the roadside. He says, "Honey, you look good. Let's make a deal. I've been a widower for a while. Let's make a deal." And she says, "Well, okay. Give me some of your stuff till you send me that little goat." So he said, "Well, sure. Here's my stuff. I'll talk out. The Bible tells the reality of life. Judah's not making good, highly favored, godly choices, is he? Okay. So, next day he sends his servant with the goat. Nobody could find the harlot. 3 months later, he gets news. His daughter-in-law has come up pregnant. And she has not kept herself waiting on his son. By the way, he was old enough, he should have already sent him to be married. And he says, bring her here that we might burn her. Well, she comes. She says, oh yeah, I'm pregnant. And by this fool stuff. Well, you know whose fool that was. It was Judah. So right in front of everybody, all the family and all the elders, there's his sin laid out. And he says, she's been more righteous than I have. He doesn't argue. He doesn't try to make an excuse. Oh, I was lonely. You know, my wife had died. He says, no, she was more righteous than me. He realizes immediately, I should have done the right thing. And the Bible says, and he never knew her again, his daughter-in-law. And she ends up having twins. So he lost 2 sons, but now he gets 2 sons back. And there's actually, now you realize his father was a twin. So here he has another set of twins in the family line. And the Bible records that those twins, they're just like his father. And his father, where they argued in the womb and they fought in the womb. And again, one's arm comes out and then he gets pulled back and the other one comes out first. Same exact thing. And the Bible records it was a miracle of God. Guess who that little baby ended up being? An ancestor of Jesus. He became an ancestor of Jesus. Now, why do I bring that up? Why does God want to discuss that with you? Why did he allow a Canaanite woman's? Why does he have all these people in the Bible? Why Judah? Why Judah? Why after the mess after mess after mess Judah got involved in? Would he say, yeah, Judah. I picked Judah to be the tribe. I want you to think for a minute. Why? Let me go on. Now, okay, this has been rough already, right? You know, he's been gone. He's been gone from his family 20 years. And it's been bad, right? He's made some bad choices. Then famine comes. Famine's so bad that there's no food anywhere. And they're going to have to go to Egypt to get food. Remember, that's where Brother Joseph got sold to, and now he's down there. And, you know, he's planning for the famine. So we see Judah goes back to his father Abraham and all his crazy brother mess. And we see all of a sudden he's in a part of this 10 brothers that's got to go to Egypt and ask for food. I want you to be thinking about what's happening in this man's life, okay? Because right now, Judah's thinking, my life's a mess. I got 2 sons by my daughter-in-law. I'm not ever going to be used by God. But God's not done. So he goes to Egypt with his brothers. And you all know how Joseph is playing with him. And he says, oh, you've got to bring Benjamin back. Well, Benjamin's the only other favorite son, which is actually his full brother by, you know, the wife that's left. So he comes, he brings him down, and he says, oh, Benjamin's staying with me. Now, 10 brothers. Which brother do you think it was who said, no, you can't have Benjamin? I'll stay. I'll be the slave instead. You know, the oldest brother had already said, he said, oh, I promise you, Dad, if we don't bring Benjamin back, you can kill my two sons. What would that help? That's crazy talk, right? But we see Judah say, and you've got to understand, this is the second highest official in Egypt. Judah, who wanted to kill his brother, doesn't know that he's talking to his brother, who is an Egyptian official now. And he says, no, you can't have Benjamin. I'll be the slave. Do you think that's a radical change? This is not the same Judah. They said, I'm so jealous of my brother, I can't stand him, I want him dead. And now he's saying, I'll protect my brother no matter what, even with my life. This is what made Judah stand out. This is what God is wanting to get to with us. You know, we think God can never use me. But you don't understand. You're not the same you that you were last year. You're not the same you were 2 weeks ago. You're not the same person. God is constantly working on you and changing you. Do you remember Judah, who spent years lying to his father about what had happened to his brother? All of a sudden, when his daughter-in-law came and said, I'm pregnant by you, he didn't argue, did he? He just confessed and repented immediately. Do you think seeing his brothers and seeing how cold-hearted and vicious they were, do you think that's why he left? I think after they did what they did to Joseph, it says immediately, then it says, and he let Judah left. I think he said, I can't deal with this anymore. I can't deal with it the way my brothers are. I don't want to be like that. But it was 20 years, at least for those boys to get to where they're old enough to marry and all that. It takes time for God to change you and get you to where he needs you to be. And see, we want it to be McDonald's drive-thru. We want, I placed my order, God changed me and used me. Okay, I'm ready for ministry. And we're so impatient. And God says, sweetheart, that's not how the process works. You've got to let me work on you. I've got to work on your character. I've got to make you more tender-hearted. I've got to make you more quick to repent. I've got to make you more loving and kind. I've got to make you willing to sacrifice yourself for others. And he says, I've got so many of these things that I have to work on you. And honey, you can't stand it if I do it all at once. Trust me, I'm your daddy, I know. And see, we think, oh, I'm such a bad person. I'm such an awful person. You know, I just messed up and, you know, I married them, and I slept with them, and I've done this, and I've lied, and I've cheated, and God could never use me. And I'm telling you, God says, I used Judah. I picked Judah out of them 12 boys. Can I tell you something? I want you to think about something. We still say he's the lion of the tribe of Judah.
Right.
Judah. Do you realize Judah's name will never be forgotten? Do you realize that we say Jews and that that is from Judah? That's where the Jews got their name from. Do you realize Judaism is because of Judah's name? Out of them 12 boys, Judah is the one that will never be forgotten. Do you realize that through this, Judah had such a radical change in his character that when they came out of Egypt 400 years later and they were given their portions of land, Judah got Bethlehem, he got Jerusalem, he got everything to the sea. Do you realize it says his portion was so great that he could not manage it all. And Simeon, the older brother that was so vicious, Simeon got a little portion inside of Judah. Because Judah's portion was so vast, the Bible says it was too much for him to control. Can you imagine having that much of a mess of a life, but being so radically changed, allowing God to change you, that God blesses you and overflows you so much that you say, hey man, I got so much, I can't even handle it. Hey, can you take some of this off my hands? That's what happened to Judah. Do you know that Judah so forever was known for protecting his little brother, Benjamin? Do you know that Benjamin's portion sits at the top of Judah? And it is wedged between Judah's portion and it is wedged in between Joseph's descendants' portions? And do you know that when the kingdom split, Benjamin, out of all those tribes, Benjamin remained with Judah forever? Even the other 10 separated with Israel, Benjamin stayed faithful to Judah. Now, why do I bring that out? Why do I say that to you? Some of the things that you do in your lifetime, some of the things that you do for people in your lifetime will so radically impact them, so radically change them, that they will forever be attached to you. Forever. There will be a forever connection between them and you and their descendants. There will be a bond. There will be a bond. Do you realize how important you are in the kingdom? That how influential you are in the kingdom if you will get your head and your heart lined up with where God wants you to be. And you know, we think it's such big things. Do you think Judah that day when he stood up and he thought, you know, he realized I could have my head chopped off from talking to this Egyptian second in command over Egypt guy and say, no, you can't have my little brother. You have to, you know, I'll be your slave forever. Speaking out of turn. Do you think when he did that at that moment, he thought, I am going to change history forever? That my name is going to be known forever because of this? No. He did that because he was motivated by love. Motivated finally for love for his brother and love for his father. I'm telling you, God is telling you, do not underestimate the power of the things that you do. Now, you don't see the ripple effect of what you do. You don't see the power of the influence of the things that you do now for people. You think, oh, it's no big deal. I'm just helping them. And you don't realize. You don't realize that changed Benjamin forever. Benjamin's descendants forever said, we're protected by Judah. know, it was not a coincidence Judah became a huge tribe and the others were smaller tribes. That wasn't an accident. Now, I know you've heard probably people talk about the tribe of Judah. They probably never brought out these things. They probably did the mainstream, oh no. And I want to bring that out because it's a part of this. The unloved mother named the fourth son Judah. She prophesied his name. You understand names oftentimes? Your name, if somebody calls your name, that's going to be prophesied to you a million times in your lifetime. Thank God they named me Victoria. Because I need that spoken over me. She shall win, because I don't know if I hadn't had that, I might be a loser. I might lose real bad. So, constantly, it was prophesied to him, praise. You're a praiser. That's what his name means. You're a praiser. Judah, you're a praiser. Now, he's heard this since he was a little boy. Right? Praiser. Do you think it's an accident that all of his descendants are praisers? No, of course it's not. Do you think it's an accident that his descendant David was out in the fields, loved to praise and worship God? No, that wasn't an accident, was it? No, he was a part of that whole tribe of people. They praised God. Now, this is something the Holy Spirit spoke to me this morning. The question for us, now that we see the things that God values, the things that he values in you, the things he's looking for in order for you to him to select you, is, are you quick to repent? When you see that you're wrong, and God shows you you're wrong, are you quick to say, I'm wrong and you were right? Do you want, you know, when God shows you something, do you want to make it right? Do you say, you know, I'm sorry, I didn't realize that before. Is your heart quick to repent? Do you want to love people? Are you willing to sacrifice yourself and what you'd like for other people? Like he did. Like Judah did. Are you willing to put other people first? And are you a praiser? This is what the Holy Spirit said. Today, we're going to worship God. And today, you, not your bloodline, not who your mom and daddy was, but today you're going to choose. You're going to choose. Are you a member of the tribe of Judah? Are you a member of the tribe of Judah? You decide that. Are you a worshiper? Are you a praiser? Do you get it? Do you get who God is? Do you get that he should be praised? Do you get that he should be worshipped? Are you in the tribe that gets it? That's what God has selected. Because if you don't get that, it means you don't get who he is. See, if you don't get who God is, then he can't have that relationship where he can use you. Because you have to get who he is for him to be able to use you. But that's step one, right? So, we're going to have some wonderful worship today. We're not going to worry about the kids. They're fine. They're going to worship on their own. But today, and you know what? We need to be thanking God that we're in a church where we're not restricted in how we worship. We're not restricted on if I want to stand by the wall, if I want restriction on if I want to sit on the floor. You don't have any restrictions in how you worship God, except leave clothes on. You don't have any restrictions in how you worship God, how you get to Him. But you're the one who decides, are you a member of the tribe of Judah? And that's what He's asking you today. That's what all this has been about, is you decide, are you a part of that tribe? Because guess what, folks? That's the tribe Jesus is in. Y'all understand that? That's the tribe Jesus came from. That's the tribe Jesus is in. Jesus is in the tribe of Jesus. I mean, Jesus is in the tribe of Judah still. He didn't leave that tribe. Okay? He's still a worshiper. The Word of God says that the Father looks to and fro seeking worshipers. Those who will worship in spirit and in truth. You can't fake it, okay? Faking it is pretending, oh, I'm worshiping. No. Father knows if it's true. If you're really worshiping Him because you know He deserves it. That's the truth. It don't have to be pretty. It don't have to sound nice. It's not about performing at all. He's not impressed. He's got angels that do that. What He's impressed by is the truth of it. Is it coming from your heart? If you will do that, the Spirit of God will anoint you and you'll begin to feel the Spirit on you. Okay? Now, some of us are more familiar with that and not, but that's okay because we've just prayed that you get more familiar with it. So at this point, I'd like to pray and bless those that have joined us online, and then we're going to move into our worship. Okay? We're going to join the tribe of Judah. Father, we just thank You so much for this word and this invitation that You're giving to us, even those that are watching online, this invitation to make a choice in their heart to be a part of the tribe of Judah. And so we pray, we ask that, Lord, that You show us all how to enter into that place of true worship with You. And then we pray, Lord, that You help us to also teach others, teach our children, and just anyone who comes to us, so that we help them to also learn how to be true worshipers of You. So we ask this blessing, Father. We ask You to continue to grow and bring more people to join us here at Trinity Worship Center. We ask these things, Father, in Jesus' name.